Welcome back to another episode of Law and Liberty, a Texas Attorney General podcast. I'm your host, Kaylee Date, and joining me is Deputy for Special Litigation, Patrick Sweeten. An issue of immigration law hits the main stage during and after each election cycle, but during this one, President Biden's administration took a dramatic step in drastically changing election law during his first day in office. On day one, the Biden administration suspended the removal of illegal aliens, even though the law specifically compels those laws to be followed. Patrick Sweeten led the charge in litigation opposing this executive order. So I was hoping today that you could give us a broad overview of this case and the issue at hand.
Sure. As you said, the agency memorandum was issued on January 20th, the first day of the Biden administration. What it did was that it instituted a 100-day pause on the vast majority of removals of illegal aliens from the U.S. And what that means is that it included a number of people who had already been given due process, had gone to hearing, an administrative law judge had later found that they were removable as illegal aliens, and it put a pause on all deportations except for a few exceptions for 100 days. As far as the timing of it, the order was issued on the 20th. We reviewed the order here in the Special Litigation Division, and we acted immediately. By Friday, 2 days after the issuance of the memo, we had filed a complaint against the administration, and we had filed a motion for a temporary restraining order. We were actually in hearing by 4 p.m. on Friday of the week that it was issued. And then the following Tuesday, the TRO was entered that restricted the government from enforcing the 100-day pause.
And I know there's a lot of meat in this case, but can you explain a little bit of what the state's lawsuit did contend?
Sure. The state alleged multiple causes of action. The first is that, contrary to federal law, that the 100-day pause basically stopped almost every kind of removal action. And federal law under 8 U.S.C. 1231A1A says that DHS shall remove the alien from the United States within a period of 90 days. That was Congress's act. Mm-hmm. And so there was that cause of action. We also had a number of APA claims, which are Administrative Procedures Act claim. And the one was that there was no explanation given for the memo. And that's referred to under the APA as arbitrary and capricious. Another was that there was no notice and comment given to stakeholders to comment on the proposed action. Another was we alleged that it was a violation of the Take Care Clause of the Constitution. And then finally, we alleged that it violated an agreement that DHS and the state of Texas had related to immigration changes.
Yeah. A lot of charges, and it seems that the court did agree with you. The U.S. District Court for the Southern District of Texas, in one of my favorite agreements, did say that the memorandum lacked a rational explanation, and they discussed the significant impact that this change would have on Texas. And this is often construed as a financial impact, but can you explain a little bit on what burdens Texas would face if this actually came down and was implemented?
Sure. The state developed evidence on a number of costs that the state has to incur, and this is mm-hmm. just a few of those. But as you know, Texas has a long border with our neighbor, Mexico.
Longest southern border.
That's right. Yeah. And so we are the recipient of a whole lot of illegal immigration. Well, that has costs to taxpayers in the state and federal taxpayers. First, it has health care costs. The federal law requires Texas to include illegal aliens in the emergency Medicaid program, the family violence program. Texas spends more than $1 million a year providing services to illegal aliens through the Texas Children's Health Insurance Program. We spend tens of millions of dollars each year on perinatal coverage for illegal aliens. Mm-hmm. Then there's another category, education costs. Under federal law, the state of Texas pays something close to $31 to $63 million for educating unaccompanied minors. And then incarceration costs are very high. Mm-hmm. Texas houses, I believe it last year, the figures were 8,900 illegal aliens in our prison systems. And of course, those have significant financial costs. And I think the estimate that we were able to develop and provide the court was that it was $152 million for Texas to house those illegal aliens. Those are just some of the costs. Of course, there are societal costs. And part of this case, we spoke with a number of law enforcement agencies about problems that are caused by illegal immigration, and those are vast, and so some of them are numerical and some of them are societal consequences.
Yes, and those consequences, and tell me if I'm wrong here, but that is a big factor in DHS's existing agreement with Texas about any kind of immigration law changes or enforcement changes. This was talked about a lot in the news, but can you explain a little bit about what was stipulated in that agreement with DHS?
Yeah, so Texas and DHS entered a memorandum of understanding, and that memorandum provided that Texas would be able to have input and dialogue regarding upcoming immigration changes. Mm-hmm. Those immigration changes, another really key component is that we would have 180 days notice of any major immigration changes. That's important because, mm-hmm. as we said, Texas is a recipient of a large portion of illegal immigration, and Texas bears a lot of the consequences of that.
Yeah. And issuing a memorandum like that on day one definitely violates any kind of 180-day warning system.
I would agree with that, and that was what we contended.
That is correct. And so looking at it from this view, with that order coming down from the executive branch, does the Biden administration have any kind of unilateral authority to affect immigration laws this way? Can they just change a law?
Well, I think in this instance, the 100-day pause, the court found that it did not. The court found that the manner and method through which the order was entered, the agency memorandum was entered, it was arbitrary and capricious, that it was inconsistent with federal law, and it did not provide, as the APA provides, the public or interested stakeholders to provide meaningful notice and comment. In fact, there was no ability to provide notice and comment to that agency decision. That was very impactful.
Did you expect a case of this magnitude to come down on day one?
Well, obviously, change was expected with the incoming administration on immigration policy. I think the magnitude of the changes that we've seen just here in the first 2 months has been jarring. There have been wholesale changes made to immigration policy, and we now have significant problems at the border. We have spoken with law enforcement agencies who have advised us of the impact of those policies. Just on the 18th of March, Press Secretary Jen Psaki indicated that there was a crisis at the border. Mm-hmm. That crisis wasn't there 3 months ago, and so it's something that we are continuing to look at. The changes, the wholesale changes that have been made, we're continuing to evaluate our legal options on those.
And obviously this case involves federal law and policy, which Texas itself doesn't affect outside of our representatives or senators. So how can we go about, through the Biden administration, ensuring that they do uphold the law and it's not just an abandonment of law and order, even when those laws already exist?
Right. So the Office of Attorney General, the Special Litigation Unit in particular, we continue to evaluate immigration policy orders that have been issued. And we, obviously we're here to protect the state of Texas's interests. So I would just say that review continues, and I would stay tuned on this issue.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Patrick. I appreciate you hanging out with us here and giving us more information about this case. Now, Ken Paxton has done several interviews about this, mm-hmm. as well, so you can check out our Twitter and Facebook pages if you would like to see those in addition to this wonderful segment here.
Thank you very much for having me, Kaylee.
Oh, it's always a joy. And we will go ahead and wrap it up. That'll do it for this episode of Law and Liberty. Thank you so much for tuning in. Check out our next episode, and I appreciate your viewership as always. Thanks, y'all.